kind of candy you want? Sweet chocolate?
Testing 1, 2, 3.
Okay, now begin.
All right.
Okay, now we're rolling.
Jack Grimmer, Mary White, Ron Mattis, Steve, something another. Melvin Avon, Frank Rowlett, Craig Head from Oklahoma, Bob Spears, Walt Farrar, his zone coordinator from North Dakota, put the truck thing together.
Ron Brackett.
Don Kimmel, Bobby Macbeth, Willis Keeson, Dick Carrier, and Ed Tverdy. And I've got one here that, another one from Kansas here, and I can't make out his name. Must not have known his name. This thing, if we recall, I believe it was Wednesday night, and Don Kimball called me and asked me, told me basically what was happening, and wanted to know if I'd meet him. Fly into Wichita and call the number when I got there and meet with them. And I told them that I would, I didn't tell him at the time, matter of fact. He called my wife, and when he called my wife, I knew what he wanted, basically what he wanted, because I knew what was going on. Then I talked to you people, and y'all said to go ahead. And then we called or talked to Devon, and then I talked to y'all. Well, I had two conversations with him. And then I went out there, and the number he gave me to call, of course, was Bob Spears' number. And I spent the night in the Holiday Inn there. The next morning I got up, and the boys from California were there. I visited with them for a little bit, and then we went out to the Canterbury Inn, and that's where we held the meeting. And the meeting didn't get started till 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon.
Saturday afternoon.
Before the meeting got started, and everybody was there except Craig Head got there late, and then Bobby Macbeth, he flew up to Nebraska and picked up Tverdy. Tverdy didn't get in until this afternoon, I guess. I don't know, the days got jumbled on, but beside the point, anyway, he got there, and meeting was started off, Bob Spears chaired the meeting, and when he opened it up and he threw it right to Warren Stauffer. Then Warren, I can't remember the guy's name without looking here. What's your grain rep's name up in North Dakota?
Sister Spitzer?
Ken Spitzer. He was the one that got up and opened the meeting up, and he gave the rundown on the everything that happened in North Dakota. And basically it was pretty well, what he said was pretty well what we had got to happen. That they had set the thing up and had their B&B account up there and this type thing. And about the zone meetings being set up there, about the home office calling meetings prior to the night their meetings were going to be held to vote on the resolution. And then he went into how that the meetings were totally sabotaged by the home office. And he gave a pretty long spiel, but he didn't get into anything too much in particular.
Let me get my notes out so I can write down that for you.
Did he talk about the vote at the meetings?
Yeah, he said that the issue was generally clouded, and that basically what taken place was an assassination by the of the home office, a character assassination of him and the rest of the leaders up there. And this was basically what he said happened, and he did get around to saying that the thing that it was voted down, the best they could tell, by about a 2-to-1 margin. This is basically what he said. Where it was voted on, there was two zones that it carried in, I believe he said. And I believe he said that in the zone that Braniff was at, that it wasn't voted on. It was tabled for
Huh? All right, now, really, they didn't get into nothing except the North Dakota thing. And really, they didn't offer any suggestions, solutions, or nothing. They just talked about their problem, and of course, I think it's just about, Devon discussed it with me before I went out there, and it's just, there wasn't nothing really to get into. And I made a few notes on it. But then they got around then, and he made his statement. California made their statement about what the situation was out there in general. And then Melvin Ayton opened up, and this was long toward in the evening. And he said that he had one statement. He wanted to make his position clear to everybody. And his attack was really what, in my opinion, started to, got the thing out. And, you know, they really opened up and got to talk. And of course, the first thing he did was to enlighten the people on how bad a shape the custodial account was in. And they have the records down there, Bill, on the this Tricker Kell outfit, and they feel like that there's some 243,000 dollars. Of funds that were misused on the Tricker Kell program, that was prepaid on the Tricker Kell and scattered all over the United States. And that there was, they got into this dollar a bushel pre-check off that was checked off for the organization. And whenever he got started on that, well then the thing really got out in open. And then at this point, well, Warren started talking, and the first thing Warren wanted to make clear that the whole problem boiled down to the Peter principle, that the entire leadership at the top, and whenever they talk about the leadership at the top, they talk about Orrin Lee, Bill, Gene, and Gordon Shaker. This is who they consider the leadership at the top. That the leadership at the top had reached their point of incompetence. And then he went into this, he got in on the custodial thing. He, according to his figures, that he had ran back contracts up there in their area. Some of the contracts was as high as $40,000. There'd be a $40,000 discrepancy between what the money the contract brought in and the money was paid out to the membership. And in cases of, none of them were correct, he said, $500 to $2,000 discrepancies. And he had run them out up there in the Marketing Area office. He knew that the account was short. And so they went around this thing all the way around. Texas talked about their problems down there some. And Kansas talked about their problems some. And then I even had to make himself clear again. And he talked about three different times on the thing. It's going to be sort of hard to really put the continuity in. It's just going to be real rough to you. Do you really get it flowing? He indicated that the NFO as an organization was some $4 to $5 million in debt, and that that's a pretty big chunk. All right, I didn't cover Kansas. Now, Kansas, Bob Spear and Frank Riley and Willis Keyes. And y'all know who Willis is. Everybody know Willis Keyes. And Willis didn't have too much to say except Willis was talking about that somebody had put the B on him from the home office after he was involved down there in Texas last year, so Willis was. And that somebody put the B on him from the home office, and he thought it was Bronoff Grahn, and that he had all of his credit shut off, and then some guy had given him $20,000 so he could keep operating. And I thought that was rather interesting. This is a statement he made, that someone gave him $20,000 to keep operating. And this was Willis Keyes. And now the Avenue, after everything was brought out, the Avenue, and he was the only one that was on it. The Avenue, or he was the main one on it, he wasn't the only one. The Avenue he wanted to go on the thing was a court injunction on the custodial account. And this thing did get quite a bit of reception from everybody. And Don Kimmel advocated it, would be that if the custodial account is, and the figure that Avon threw out on the custodial account was some $800 to $1 million, that the custodial account was absolutely short. And that if it is short, or regardless, that any member out there that has grain going through the custodial account can immediately ask the government to put an injunction on that account for freezing. And this is one of the avenues that they're thinking about going. Now, Warren Stockton wasn't too much for this. Warren felt like that the best way to do it would be to cut the funds off from the organization. Just absolutely cut all the funds off. Then it would make the custodial account, the float decrease, make the shortage show up. And at the same time, you would cut down any funds going into the general fund. And when you did that, then this would take the money away from the organization, and then you'd have it where you wanted it. This is the route he wanted to go. And that meant quit selling. Well, Kansas agreed that was a good route, that they'd already quit selling. And Texas agreed it was a good route, they'd quit selling. Now, California on the thing, California was the most reasonable group out there. They didn't want to go for broke on it. And what they were talking about was the way they had been working, and it was working reasonably successfully. The only thing they might want to do would be to set up their own custodial account out there. And then eventually then that was what they were going to do, was set up their own custodial account out there. But now they never did get involved until this afternoon, really, as far as a complete move to change the present administration. I don't know, y'all going to have to ask me some questions. It's just hard as the dickens to just come out of it. Some figures that they threw out up there were, and I've got them here just a second. North Dakota here, they said there was 40,000 short on one contract, and he said $2,000, $700, $600, and we named it. Practically every account that was short, every contract, the balance didn't work right on any of the contracts, or the majority of the contracts.
Do you mean the members were short monies?
Well, no, the account was short in most cases. The account was short in most cases. In most cases, and what it was, that right there is an important point, because I wrote, made a note of it. Now, what he said was that he knew of one individual that was paid. He knew of one individual that was paid twice. And the individual was holding the check, and I believe he said the check was for $12,000.
Did he say the individual's name?
No, he never would. Here's a $12,000 one that was paid twice. Here's a $2,000, and this is the only one you might have a possibility, or you can find out.
Now, this $12,000 Bismarck also?
Yes. Now, here's the only one, though, that you can find out for a fact what it is. So, Bill, here's one for $2,056 that was paid twice. And this was quite a while ago. And here's another one for $12,000 that was paid twice. And these people are holding the checks, evidently. But anyway, they've been paid twice. Now, he's, of course, I better not get on opinions yet here. But anyway, Warren Stauffer did make these statements right here, because I got North Dakota. The truckers have been paid two or three times
several times up there. Warren made that statement. I got Willis Keys in there.
What they say they've done about it to correct it?
Oh, they never did. Of course, you know that. You know how that goes, Shelley. If you correct your problems, you don't wind up with a big mess of them, do you?
Can I ask you
some questions? Now, the reason why I'll have to skip here, if we go through it, see what turns around here, see, then Avon starts talking again, really. Yeah, go ahead.
Was cotton discussed at all?
No, way toward the evening, the cotton thing was discussed. And I don't know, and I really, I'd just soon not know who the other individual was in the meeting, just to be honest with you about it. And I'd just soon him not, if there was another individual from the organization in the meeting, and I'd just soon for him not to know that I was in there right now. But anyway, the point I'm trying to make is that Don Moskal was in the meeting.
Well, I know that, but what I'm getting at is...
And Cotton was mentioned way late.
Yeah, we've got some problems in Cotton, and I just want to know if it was mentioned as one of these things that was mismanagement.
Yeah,
I
don't really think maybe that it was mismanagement. Just the fact that maybe the organization or Donovan one stood liable for some $1 million was the only figure that was ever mentioned.
Well, did they mention the fact that they were going to use this as, were they going to sabotage it or anything?
Well, they felt like, no, it never was.
That's what I'm getting at.
No, that was never even considered, just it was mentioned.
Yeah, I won't ask him why.
Well, no, you just asked him now. All right, see what happened. Here's Warren talking. Now then, he was talking about the truckers being paid twice. Then Avon starts talking. They were talking about the custodial account. And then they were talking about how the money, what was happening to the money that was in the account. And the thing come up on the treasurer bills, and Avon said that there were some treasurer bills bought one time, and the figure I've got here is $1 million worth. But he said a real float doesn't exist, says it. The real float can never be over $500,000. Then he goes on here, he gets to talking, and while he's on that subject, and he's talking about the Okie Vernon Bank and the fact that they sent a bill over there for $1,700. There's more questions back and forth, and then they asked, well, what about the reserve fund? He says the reserve fund doesn't exist, said they're all in the same account. And they asked what it's ever been used for, and he says that there's $360,000 spent on a soybean contract, and then he comes to the fact that he feels like that the custodial account is $1 million short. And then he says that, but that's about natural because the NFO didn't ever shut the door till the horse is out. And he says here that the thing was $750,000 short, and I've got here when he started, that it was he felt like it was about $750,000 short, the custodial account. And I've got Avon's name wrote down there. And then here, see, I got to rambling there a while ago, but then it's sort of hard to keep straight on it. Then they start talking about the three trustees studying the account. The three, evidently, is three trustees assigned by the board or some such fashion to study the account, all right? So then they start talking about the three trustees, and then they say the reason that the three trustees can't tell if the account's short is because they're looking at the current in and out movements of it over a given period of time, and not actually from day one to from the day it started to where we're up to right now. That they're looking at the account on a starting one 30-day period and end another 30-day period with no knowledge of what happened to it prior to that. Okay, so they say then that the trustees don't know anything, they wouldn't be able to tell exactly whether the custodial account's short or not. Now then, at this point, along in here somewhere, go ahead while it's on my mind, Ed Tverdy is in there, and Ed had consulted a lawyer on the thing as far as who would be responsible if there was a $1 million deficit.
in the Custola camp. And it's brought to their attention then that if they knowingly approved the report of the Custola camp, there was any shortage whatsoever, then the entire board stands responsible for the shortage. It's like a brick. So, anyway, he brought this out. Now, I made the point of what I even said about the general account, didn't I?
No.
About the general, now he said the general account, or the organization, I'm sorry, the organization being $4 to $5 million in debt, period. Okay, we're just going through generally what was said. They start talking about the inefficiency and mismanagement of the organization. And I'm sure y'all want to know what they're talking about, not just what they come up with what they were going to do to
solve.
Okay.
Everything.
All right, that's what I thought. All right. So then they start talking about the mismanagement of the organization and the fact that they had 30 girls in one typing pool, or in one pool there, 30 secretaries in one pool, that do nothing but file a membership's card under alphabetically county and state. They had only one girl in the entire home office that could take shorthand, and in short, the help was just no good at all in the home office. This is Avon talking. Now then they start, they're still giving their weather reports here. Avon, he's sort of like Nixon. He wanted to make one point clear, but he made them clear several times throughout here, if you'll watch when I tell you when Avon's talking. All right, then the guy from Oklahoma starts talking.
Craighead,
okay. And he's talking about the feeder problems down there, and The only thing that he said, basically, was the fact that they had some problems on their contracted cattle down there, and they had one producer that wouldn't deliver. And he wanted, if he was going to deliver, he's going to have to be paid $1 over the contract price. He wanted to make the man stay with the agreement, either deliver the cattle or pay off the note. And he couldn't get it done. Finally, the feeder department negotiated an agreement that the signee would pay the $1 over the contract price for the set of cattle. And it was due then after he was questioned on it. It was due to discrepancy between the day the contract for sale was dated and the day the note was dated. Okay, this was all he said at that point. Then Don Mosca started talking, and he said that basically we were in here to try to pull NFO together. That we had a power structure at the top, and the power structure was made up of Bill Lashman, Ornley Staley, Gene Potter, and he just goes through three of them. That's all. He gives it to three people, and then along in that time, Gene, there's a new word put your name here. Then Melvin says, he says Bill Lashman and Ornley Staley. And he didn't say Gene Potter. And so Avon says, don't forget Gene Potter, you know, Little Napoleon's in there. Thought that was a good name for you anyway. Now, every time, or at any time in here, and you just stop anywhere and stretch it, because there was a lot of conversation going over every point that was made. But this was basically what he said. It's basically what California was saying, too, that they were trying to pull collective bargaining back together again. Of course, every one of them was saying that in there. Now then, everyone at this point have all pretty well, or three or four of them have pretty well decided that the ones I've mentioned there, that the leadership and the management at the top was all goofed up. So they start looking for solutions. So immediately then, they want to know where Fink stands in the thing. And Warren Stauffer starts it off, and he tells us that Fink is absolutely down memory lane. That he's down memory lane.
You mean living in the past?
Living in the past. And well, that was his words. I never had heard it used this hard that way. But anyway, this is the words he used, was that Fink was down memory lane, that he was living in the past, and that he was done as far as being effective for collective bargaining. That what he was going to do, that he'd go out to the people. The best thing they could do with Fink was let him go ahead and do what he's doing right now. That he would go out to the people, and by constantly saying the same thing for hour after hour, that eventually, that he'd already destroyed himself in a lot of the areas with the people, and that eventually he would destroy himself everywhere by constantly living in the past and not facing up to the future. And then Warren tells about meeting with someone, and I better make a point here. Now, one of the objects of the whole thing is to start driving wages and creating suspicion in the home office, okay? So I don't know when they dropped these things to get them in here, or whether they were serious or anything, but the object is to get, and this was made plain several times, is to get Orrin Lee looking out the side of his eye at Lashman's, you know, because Lashman's coordinating this meeting they had today, see? Now, you know, this is the object of the thing. All right, now then.
Lashman's coordinating the meeting we had today.
Yeah, down at Wichita. You know, I mean, this is type thinking they're going to try to promote, okay, Gene? In other words, if they could say it enough that Lashman's wanting to call that meeting down there behind the scenes, okay, then Orrin Lee's going to start looking out the side of his eye at Lashman. Or maybe Gene called it, see? Okay? Right? Okay, this is what they're going to do. Now then, that's the reason why a lot of this stuff, it's going to be hard for you to sort out when they're trying to drop something to get in here, because it was made very plain that they wanted the Stooley to come in, see? You know. Kimmel made this real plain there.
Out of that meeting. Yeah. They wanted somebody to come in out of that meeting.
Yes, sir. Matter of fact, they wanted somebody to come in and out of the meeting and then feed, you know, back to them, you know, to be able to put inside information out of their camp into this camp, okay? Follow me? Mm-hmm. Oh, okay, now I just want to make that point clear, because I don't want to insinuate that anybody out there said anything, you know, outside of that crew was down there. All right, then Warren starts telling about Don Burkhorn. Said he had Don ready to spill his guts in the restroom up there at Bismarck, I suppose, or Jamestown, wherever y'all had those meetings at. And Bombard walked in on him. But he had started talking about was the evidently shortage in the dairy custodial account. Now, whether there's anything at all to this or anything, I don't know. But anyway, he insinuated that Don Burkhorn, you know, would pull over into the right camp. But now then, it's going to be a concentrated effort to make everybody in the home office believe that they've got a pipeline in here that just isn't going to quit. And everybody better think real serious about that. That right there could have a lot of effect. That's one of the things. Okay, then Avian comes back in here, Bill, with this thing about the processors, the insurance we've got with the processors, and the fact that most of the people we're doing business with in the past haven't been insured anyway. Period. There hadn't been any follow-up work done on it, hadn't been any administration done on it, and that this insurance premium is fantastically high, which we were supposed to be aware of that anyway. But the curious thing about the whole thing is that that Lashmet does all negotiating on this thing. He's the only one that talks to him as far as negotiating out the terms of this contract. And
Terms of the insurance contract?
Yes, sir. Okay. And then he drops it right here that then, and they've got a cabin in Canada.
Is that what?
A cabin in Canada.
Who
the insurance people have.
So what's that got to do with it?
Well, they're insinuating that Lashmet's been using it. Kevin and Ken.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Then they start talking again. They get back on the subject. They start talking about the Dairy Custodial account in Wisconsin being $300,000 in the red, the Dairy Custodial account in New York being $250,000 in the red, and then whoever said that. And I'm sure that at this point, California said it. I wrote save NFO because somebody said, well, our purpose here, you know, is to save NFO. And, you know, not just constantly try to pick the thing apart on assumptions, you see what I mean? And then Avon comments that Ornelise Daly doesn't want NFO to go, doesn't want NFO to work. Okay. And then here I got OLS again and Avon talking that Orrin Lee was one of the greatest performers that ever was and the greatest motivator of people that ever was.
Who is?
Orrin Lee.
Who said that?
Avon.
Okay.
Okay. One of the greatest performers that ever was, one of the greatest motivators of people that ever was. He said that whenever Orrin Lee would have a problem come up and he wanted to go to the board of directors and he was ready to pull something over on them, that he'd stay up two or three nights in a row prior to the board meeting to get the necessary sags under his eyes and to be in a physical, mental state to get up there and put the program to him. And well, let's see.
Can I ask you some questions?
It starts getting rough right here.
What do you mean it starts getting rough?
Huh?
What do you mean it starts getting rough?
What they're talking about, that's all. Yeah, go ahead, Shelby.
Well,
that's what, I mean, I'm going to say it. I mean, it don't bother me. Orrin Lee said, you know, you get tough, and I reckon. I used to stutter. I don't anymore.
Most of these accusations come from Melvin Avon.
No. After it's all said and done, I don't think anyone.
He kind of spearheaded this. Did he spearhead this idea?
Well, he finally got up. He got up and he led the first. He dropped the bomb. Is what his words were on the $264,000 that were misused. He indicated directly that Lashmet misused this money that was paid off to, and I missed that point, paid off to FMS.
Okay, can I question that and develop it right now? Did he point out that to the people there that Bill Lashmet was one of the major stockholders of S Farm Service Management?
No, he said that in Kansas City when the thing was negotiated that an offer was made to him to buy stock in FMS, and that he turned it down, saying that he thought it was highly unethical of a official of the organization owning stock in it. And another individual there did the same thing, but now I don't know about the rest of them, he says, indicating that Lashmet probably did own some stock in FMS. And then he also, and I may have made a note of it, or I may not say, you couldn't just sit there. Wasn't nobody else writing. There was the two boys from California and Macbeth sitting over there drawing X and O's, and you couldn't sit there and just constantly write. And Willis Keevan sitting right here, you know, and I'd lean back up against the wall, you know, and he'd lean back up against the wall with me, see. So, I mean, you just couldn't write constantly.
All right. Did Melvin bring up the point that Bill authorized extra monies to be paid to Dr. Jerry Kelly to keep the corporation going that Kelly had?
Right.
He brought that up, didn't he?
$224,000.
Yeah. Is that right?
Now this is a misuse of funds, right?
That's right. Okay.
Had you heard that before?
Oh, yes, I've heard it.
Where'd
before?
You hear that?
Down at, sure. Now this is why I'm laughing at all everything that Bobby's given us. Here is the fact that I've heard this whole goddamn discussion before, word for word. All right, now can I go on a little bit about this? All right, now was the next point brought out that Orrin Lee absolutely didn't want this organization to grow because he couldn't control it then, and he didn't want it to get away from him.
Basically, that's right.
Okay. So therefore, he was doing everything he could to...
If you've ever heard it once, you've heard it. Everything was said. I've
okay.
heard it before.
Now, the next thing was, did they bring out the inference that Bill was taking money and Orrin Lee was completely snookered and didn't know it, and Bill was getting away with this, and this is why the custodial account was short?
Well, no, they didn't. They didn't say. Never any insinuation made that Orrin Lee didn't know anything about it. There's the only... They said misuse of funds, and then started back 4 or 5 years ago, Bill, when you bought your farm, and then up till today, the fact of what kind of farm you had, and that you had gross sales of $100,000 off a 323-acre farm.
Also, they bought new cars
and Lashman sold his trigger cow, which they're going to get some mileage out of this if they use it, for $11.50. Bushel this year, or this past year, whenever it was.
The money on it, did you?
Damn right.
Okay. Well,
I'm going to do it again this year too.
That was one of the. This is the same damn thing they had.
But they are. They're going
word for word.
You know, they're going to get with a lot of these people. That's the only thing I see that they might make. But anyway, anything else?
So long before NFL had a program.
All right. Did Melvin go on and say that every time he asked for an accounting of the custodial account, or every time he wanted to know the status of the reserve account, that he was absolutely refused access to it? That no one could tell him, even if they wanted to?
Right.
Okay. Can't think of the rest of them. I interrupted you. You got to the point where you said it was going to get rough. And
I don't think it'll get all rough. Huh? But then, at this point, Warren was one that said it right here. I've got Warren and Avon, and Avon had said the top part. And at this point, Warren says that Orrin Lee is sick, that he is paranoid and insecure, is basically what he was getting at, that he was paranoid of his insecurity of his job, and that Potter has the brains, and that got a good laugh. Potter has the brains. I mean, it wasn't said as a compliment.
Who said that?
Stoffer.
This is the same thing he said in March. Same damn thing, word for word.
So then, at this point, then the first strategy that they were talking about using was playing directly on your insecurities. They give example of it, of writing this letter and sending in the second page. You know anything about Gene? 3-page letter, and they sent the second page into the office.
Mm-hmm.
You heard anything about it? Well, he sure got a lot of mileage out of it.
What letter?
Well, it was a letter, and it was sort of about halfway coded. Gene, you know, coded.
Letter from who to?
Well, the letter came in here, postmarked Ohio, into the home office. Okay? And it came to Chris Walker. Well, now they sure got the mileage out of it. They've got their program laid right behind that letter. Well, the letter, basically what it was, it was a page two of a letter. Mark page two. Okay, it started in, it left off with a, it started, the letter, the page started off in the middle of a thought, okay? And then the letter was coded. You know, you're going to have a meeting at so-and-so place, except it was by code, and so-and-so and so-and-so is going to be there. Y'all ain't heard nothing about it.
Mm-hmm. We probably thought it was an action reply from some member.
Well, now, this, they really, matter of fact,
who was that talking about, Ailey or Kimball?
No, Stoffer.
Never heard of him. Didn't hope that.
They thought we'd be all upset about this letter or something?
Yeah.
Was it diversionary?
I was trying to find out where the meeting was at. What I'm trying to think of, it seems to me like that somebody said that, and I guess it could have been Avon, that there's a staff meeting called over. I'm sure it was.
Over that letter?
Yeah, maybe I'll get on over in there.
This has happened sometime in the past.
No, it hadn't been too long ago. It's just been recently.
Wouldn't be too recent if Calvin knew about a staff meeting.
Who's that?
What about Dick Carey? What he had known about?
Yeah, Dick Carey was there. Well, Dick was here after Melton.
That's what I was thinking. But anyway, this is where they came up then, that they play on the insecurity. Of course, Shelley's heard this, maybe, and I guess maybe some of the rest of it. We'll run through it real quick. Then they talk about Orrin Lee Staley and Earhart Pinkston not understanding collective bargaining, and that they spot sell their commodities. And that on one given day, Fink walked in and asked the grain department to sell 2,000 bushels of soybean that day. Said they don't understand collective bargaining. And they told about that sign up on the bill. Moss Rudolph signed your grain up on the bill of sales. This is what they said. It says Dick Carey said he couldn't understand how the leaders expected the other people to participate when they wouldn't participate. And then they talked about Bronoff Grand coming into the grain department with an NFO check, and he had sold his rye. And he was docked. He got docked on it. I didn't put down a percentage, but anyway, got docked on it. And he said, this is the way you get screwed when you mess with NFO. Let NFO mess with your grain. He took the balance out of the local elevator.
Let's stop right there, because I remember that incident. That happened after Carrier left his office.
No, he said it was rye. That was flax.
What was flax is what I'm thinking of.
Yes, is the one you're thinking of, and I don't know whether there has been another one or not, but that will be, we better find out about that.
I know of one where Ron came in. It was flax.
Flax. Do you know any more facts about that?
No.
Do you know how long ago it was?
Says it was the NFO. Dick Carey was talking. I've got Dick Carey. Leaders will not participate. Ronald Grahn brought an NFO check in, laid down his desk, and said, this is the way you get screwed when you mess with NFO. Remember him saying that? Sold a rye, and he got docked. Seems to me like he said he got docked 11%. And he took the balance to the local elevator and didn't get any dock at all.
Does me too, because he had a test that he took the local elevator to get the quality tested.
That sounds like the flax dealer.
Yeah, it does me too. It does. That happened about 2 weeks ago. That's after he come back.
Correct.
Vacation.
Carrier wasn't here, so that means someone talked to Carrier. There's only two people in the office when that happened.
You might ask them. Bronoff does raise rye, boys.
I know he does, so we got to ask Bronoff. See whether Bronoff has said anything about rye or not. So I want to check this and talk to Brown.
It is, I know.
I didn't realize
Brown was about.
I didn't ask Trey.
Right here.
I didn't realize it. Really, yes, sir. But I made
some things will mean some things to us.
Made a lot of notes here. Avon sure did a lot of talking.
Avon did.
Yeah. And then Avon talks again. I don't know when. Avon says he does not want to store NFO.
Doesn't want to do what?
Destroy.
Doesn't want to destroy an effort. But Ornelie Staley cannot build it. So the thing he thinks we should do is set up custodial accounts and all the marketing. There's just not much left anyway. This is what he says. And if we set it, of course, then I went through what happened when they set the custodial accounts up, okay?
No.
Well, whenever they set the custodial accounts up in the area out there, then it stops the money coming into this custodial account up here.
Yeah.
Okay? Now then, see, they also keep their money. Now then, they don't send any check off in or anything. Period. They don't send any of it in. No, it's just the same identical thing as North Dakota.
Right.
No difference as far as what that part of the strategy is.
Did they read that resolution?
Yeah.
They read the resolution at the meeting?
Now these resolutions are going to be sent out, mailed out in California, Texas, Kansas, Oklahoma. Same thing.
Could we get that into the report?
Too late, see, they're going to do it.
They're
going to do it this week, so that's the reason why I told Gene tonight. I thought we were going to talk. Of course, best time to debrief the guys right whenever he's fresh. But anyway, but they're going to start. See, they're starting their first meetings tomorrow night, actually.
And voting on the resolution.
Well, they're going to start their first action meetings tomorrow night. And then I guess it'll be Texas, and down in there will be Wednesday night. And anyway, they're starting their first meetings tomorrow night.
Well, I'm not clear on that yet. Are they going to start reading the resolution and getting it voted on? Or are they just going to start the agitation
they're
so that there's the primer for the resolution? What was their deadline for getting the resolution passed?
Well, I am getting a deadline. Really, I'd rather wait till we go through all the subversive action at the end of it. Get what they, in other words, what they're going to attack you on. These are the points they're going to attack you on. One other thing, one lady that they brought out, now Avon did, is the fact that Lashput and Ornelie both do business over at Okey Vernon Bank, insinuating that you probably borrowing unsecured money over there. This is what he said. When did Avon resign from the grain department?
About 3 weeks before you accepted, wasn't it, Ornelie? 2 or 3 weeks?
No.
When did that seem?
I talked to Shelley on
the 19th of June.
I called Shelley.
About the 10th of June.
You say, Bill?
About the 10th, somewhere around the 10th of June, I don't know exactly, but we've been around that time. Well, someplace in there.
That was 1 week later, I'm not going to argue with you, Bill.
I wondered how it lasted from March. Avon here talks about the Lashman Incorporated 326-acre farm and the fact that this was probably not feasible to incorporate a farm of that size. But then the fact that there was $100,000 worth of growth product sold off the farm last year.
How'd you get that figure?
I don't have any idea where he got it. Whatsoever, that's just a figure he threw out there.
He mentioned
wasn't right anyway.
Well, I know that, Bill, but he mentioned that before, and I'm trying to remember how he justified, because that night he was asked how he got that figure. And I can't remember what the answer was. That's why I was asking you.
All right, then they start talking about, and I've already discussed this, it's draining off of the general fund. And of course, one way that they're hoping to drain off the general fund is when they start their meetings. The amount of money and the manpower is going to be thrown in those meetings. Of course, really, it won't be too bad because you've done clean the house enough that you're saving a lot of money that you were wasting. So it ain't going to be near as bad as they think it is it? And the board is a big joke. Board is a farce.
Who said that?
Warren Stauffer. It's a farce. Board is a farce. Board is a big joke. And this is what they're going to try to do. The first board meeting is they're going to start her off in a just that manner, if they can.
In what manner?
A big joke.
they mention why it was a joke? Did they say that the first thing that happened was that Ornley come in and asked everybody how his area was doing, and that took up a half of one day?
Yeah, they talk about giving the crop reports.
And then
what they call it.
Right. And then did they say that by doing this, it diverted everybody's attention so that Orrin Lee could present whatever program he wanted to and then push it right on through?
Oh, yeah, late night.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, that's been going around for, that ain't the first time it's ever came up.
No, but it's all part of this same thing.
And then they started talking, and they're getting down, and last night, part of this was coming into last night of what to do, you know, getting down to what to do. And their plans are on that angle, then. Of course, on the big joke, I think, and you'll have to hit me on this some. The first thing, the first order of business is going to be to vote to exclude everybody from the board except the board members, the president and officers. It's going to be the first thing to do. And then to suspend the crop reports, as they call them. But, and then take the department reports one at a time on each department. And as the department head starts into his report, in an organized effort, they're going to vote to table his report, stop his report. And they're going to hackle him quite a bit. This is, in other words, they're going to plan on disrupting the board meeting. Is what they're planning on doing. But they're going to make an effort from now until then to get into every district convention and get people on the bylaws. What they're wanting to do, there's a lot of things they want to change, a lot of the bylaws they want to change. And this is everybody, I mean, it's not just Texas, you know, been the ones wanting to change them. But this is, everybody was there. Now, Colorado wasn't there because the guy didn't have money to get there, I understand. Now, y'all might know better than that. Lick, but he wasn't there. But
is this his name?
Huh?
Yeah, Lick.
Yep, Lick. Name I thought they mentioned.
He was the director.
Is that right? He's no longer a director. Okay. But the one of the things that they're wanting to push through on the bylaws is to limit the terms of the president. Of course, you're all probably aware of this. They want to limit the terms of the president. And what they're going to do. Another thing is on this insecurity thing, and what they want to do is to start the rumors out there that so-and-so's running for president. Kimmel's going to run for president. Try to get his picture and everything in the report that he's running for president. And then the theory being that then the guns will be leveled on Kimmel, and a couple of weeks later, somebody else is announced as president. And then at the board meeting, they're going to suggest an all-out holding action. They're going to try to push an all-out holding action through. Suggest to the people out in the country and to Ornley that they've got a pipeline into the home office. You know, somebody's always leaking something out to them out there. And they want to, of course, they want to set these rumors up, scatter them everywhere. course, then the main thing, if we get into so much repetition, it's going to be hard for me to
worry about saying it two or three times.
What would only do it? Ken was to run for president. What angle would he attack him from?
Ken Stauffer?
Yeah.
Was that discussed?
Yeah.
Who brought that up?
Warren. Would it be on a personal basis or what? And then the statement was made, it better not be on a personal basis. And that was made by Warren. He better not get on a personal basis on something. But what would Ornley do if Ken ran for vice president? And would it be personal? That's exactly what I was
Vice president
about.
Or president?
President, I'm sorry. President. Right. And let's see. Let me see who's talking here. Stauffer's talking. He's recapping. We'll expose Augusto Locale. Take about 60 days. Don't sell anything. He lines it this way. Staley, Schaefer, Lashman, and Potter. And he says, and Potter, and this, again, I done clarified it, but he says that the three will go together, and that Potter will ride the tide on the thing. That's what he says. They raised quite a bit of hell about selling this on this Farley contract where they had a 2 cent reserve, not being able to get that money. Now then they get in onto the sixth state, this grain that was sold, I guess, last week or something like that it was sold, and the members weren't able to take advantage of the spout charge. 2 cent spout charge had been paid in advance.
3 cents spout charge.
3 cents spout charge.
And that's a charge that Avon has always made, or I knew he was going to make, but there's nothing to it.
No. And that they sold the grain, not the warehouse receipts. Lost 2 cents. Who got the 2 cents? Then they brought up something about this some grain out here, and this is Tverdius in here at this point. And they named the elevator out here in Nebraska.
Nebraska City Elevator?
No, that's not it. But anyway, about a half cent brokerage fee was paid.
Smooth grain.
Right, smooth grain.
I knew you'd bring that up because he burned it up Friday. Did he mention that he wanted to know why in the hell we should pay the half cent when American grain owed us money?
Well, yeah, that's just brought up quite a bit, too.
Yeah.
Okay, now then, here's the steps, see? Step one is to break the custodial account and force an audit. And they're going to try to force an audit, of course, on the board, full up. And, of course, they're going to drop the brick on the rest of the board members that they're all responsible for the account being short. And the minutes done read now. They approved the account being short, okay, and then they're all responsible for things, so we better find out where we're standing now. And expose the shortage and hold the check off and choke off the funds. This is step one. And step two is to kill, and this is somebody else here, is to kill Lashman, Fairbanks, Schaefer, or Potter. And,
You mean actually assassinate him?
No. Assassinate the character. And what they're going by is that they'll be able to, if they start putting pressure on any one of these guys here, to force them out of the organization through the board, that Ornley not getting his way will throw a temper tantrum. Because he can't run the organization, and that he'll threaten to resign, and whenever he threatens to resign, then they'll accept his resignation.
Was that talking Kimball?
No, this was Kimball and Stauffer both said this, said that this would work, said they'd seen it happen before. Then they start to see. Who's Spinner?
Butch Spinner, Illinois.
Is he there?
No. Was Bernie Seymour.
Was Bernie there?
No. These are people they feel like they can pull with.
Uh-huh. Who else?
That was all in, that was only two. This is something they're real evasive about. And I, of course, you just couldn't put the pressure there that you wanted to, you know. I mean, I tried to, you know, not to do no more than I had to, and then I wound up as southeastern coordinator of the whole damn deal, you know. But I couldn't get anything, really. There was, they're going to do it, but now as, I didn't stay up with them last night. I went to bed, and about 2 o'clock this morning, and I never did go to any of them's room or anything. So really, there's some meetings that I wasn't in on, you know, 100% I know. But there's never any organized effort for the Midwest, Minnesota, Wisconsin, Ohio. Now what they're probably going to do, they're going to go in there to some of the people that have been leaders. This is most likely what they're going to do. This is what I told them I was going to do in the Southeast. Okay, Marion Green, this type of thing, you know. And we got to figure out a way for me to get around that one yet. But I guess the thing to do is go see them. But anyway, this is what they're evident. But there was never any discussion except Spinner. And I'm trying to see, remember, and I think Kimball, says, told me, says that something other about the custodial account being short and this type of thing. Benny Seaman may think he can pull him, go with him. Now then, at this point, Warren wants to bring out a point. Warren says, now I'll tell you, I'm not going to be any part of it if it's going to be any damn secrets whatsoever. No damn part of it. Don't want any part of anything with secrets. And I just made that point because that's where he made it. Okay, then this is today. They're discussing it this morning.